We have been studying about impulse voltage measurements and generalizations on dividers, etc. So this was the layout which we have seen, and then transfer characteristics we were studying for this four-terminal electrode system or four-terminal equivalent system of the measuring system. Now, this also we have covered. Normalized amplitude frequency response of lightning impulse, and based on which we can say that a particular bandwidth can be decided for accurate measurements. And then step response and response times, how to calculate, we have seen. So this is the definition of response time based on unit step response. And response times with chopped impulse response also we understood. And certain drawbacks of the criteria we have discussed, and also we have recognized its importance in spite of these drawbacks, that it can be, the computation can be simple, can be done. Of course, not at real layout, but some standard layout accepted by standards. Now, today we will see generalized computation of the four-terminal network that we have seen earlier. So, the generalized computation is based on Laplace transform actually, which can be used for representing the four-terminal network that we have discussed earlier. So, as per Laplace transform, so Vi of S and Ii of S are the input variables, and then V naught and I naught are the output variables at the measuring instrument. So, these are input are at a test object, and this is the system matrix and A. Okay, so state matrix. Now the input impedance can be shown to be like this. So the reason here is I naught S is can be assumed to be zero almost. The reason is the divider normally have very low impedance at the output end, but from there also the parallel impedance of the cable or terminating impedance or input impedance of the instrument will be high, so that the current I naught can be assumed to be zero. If that is assumed to be zero, then Zi of S, that is input impedance, Vi of S divided by Ii of S. For example, if this is zero, then this multiplied by this equals to Vis, and then this multiplied by this is equal to Iis. So simply the ratio of Vis by Iis is simply the ratio of A11 of S by A21 of S. That's what is given here. Similarly, Hs, the transfer function, what is the output actually? V naught S, that output voltage. And the input is Vis. So this transfer function can be shown to be 1 by A11 of S. So V naught S divided by Vis is 1 by, because this is 0, I of S is 0. So the relation between this is gone by this one, right? And out of which A11 S into V naught S is equal to Vis you will get. So from that, this transfer function can be obtained. So this is a generalized transfer function of the four-terminal equivalent network of the measuring system. Now, response times, how to compute the response times from the Laplace transform of H. Now here, N, the divider ratio. What is the divider ratio? Or, ratio of input to output. Actually, this this n constitutes not only divided ratio but also the resistance, damping resistance also involved. Ratio of the voltage
sir,
at the input
here.
Means
sorry,
that the test object. Hello?
Sir, the voice was cut in middle.
Oh, now are you able to hear to me now? Listen to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now it's clear.
Achha. So until now you did not listen or only for a few minutes there was a break?
For a few seconds there was some cut in the voice, sir.
Only this slide, sir. This slide.
Only this slide. This slide from when you started explaining N.
Okay. So N actually...
Again breaking, sir.
Sir, again the voice is
divider,
Again breaking,
again
sir.
The voice broke. Breaking.
Shall I restart?
No, oh. Sir. Only this slide, sir. This slide.
This slide. This slide.
I think better I restart the system so that you will be able to listen, I think. Shall I? Or no need?
Right now it's clear, sir, but when you started, it's getting the signals breaking.
Okay, right now it is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If there is anything you didn't understand, you ask me to repeat. That's it. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So, N, I was explaining, N is the ratio of input voltage. This input voltage is the voltage at the test object. And this is the output voltage, is the voltage at the measuring instrument. So this is what I was mentioning. So this is not, that capital N is not exactly the divider ratio. There is a difference here because the effect of damping resistor R2 is also involved in this, which is, after the test object, damping resistor and then divider. This is divider will be there. And from after that signal cable, etc. Right. So this input and then output ratio involves not only divider ratio, but the effect of damping resistance will also be involved in this. That's what I would like to point out. Then, so what is this value actually? What is this statement? N equals to limit S tends to 0. Vi of S by V naught of S. Why is this statement written like this? What is the meaning?
So we are finding the final value.
Little bit louder, please.
We are trying to find the final value, sir.
Final value, not exactly final value. Yes, tends to zero means what?
At low frequencies, sir.
At low frequencies are DC, right? Constant value. So in that case, the ratio is called N, right? So that is what we are doing here. Vi of S by V naught of S. So on low, very low frequencies. Is equal to N. That is if you go back and see, this is 1 by A11 of S, that H of S. So it becomes A11 of 0. This N, the ratio, that normalizing factor. Now, the normalizing factor is known. With normalizing factor, if you multiply the transfer function, then normalized transfer function you will get. This is the normalized transfer function. Once you know the transfer function, normalized transfer function, how to get step response? Transfer function means what?
We have to do inverse Laplace.
Yeah, you have to multiply the transfer function with unit step function to get a step response, right? So that's what is done here. Of course, here again it is not normalized. Capital HS into 1 by S is the step response. Of course, it is not normalized. And then Laplace inverse will give you the step response capital GT. And if you normalize this, you will get GT equals to N times GT. So now you got the step response, right? From step response, you can estimate the value of T naught. That's what we have studied until now, right? So you can obtain the step response using the transfer function of the system or by taking inverse Laplace transform of 1 by S multiplied by H of S. So from that you can estimate T naught. Now how to estimate T naught also, let us see. Now we know the final value theorem, right? So here actually this is infinity. Limit f of t tends to infinity is equal to limit s tends to 0 s into f of s, right? So this we have to apply here to get the, you know, t naught value. So t naught is simply limit s tends to 0 1 minus h of s by s. Why 1 minus s, 1 minus h of s by s? Why is it like this?
The step response, sir.
Huh?
Step response.
This is step response. This is T naught.
Yes, sir.
T naught was earlier defined as S of T minus T. It was defined 1 minus G of S, sir. So
1 minus G of T integral, right?
Yes, sir.
So what is 1 there?
That 1.
Step function. G of T is step rest.
Yes, sir.
Inside you can see. Okay.
Sir, your voice was cut, sir, completely. We could not hear anything.
Hello?
Yes, hello? Sir. Now we are good. Hello?
Am I clear?
Now you are audible, sir. Before the voice was cut.
Okay, so the the term inside the limit is exactly the definition of T naught.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this limit S tends to 0, if you apply, what will happen now, sir? The numerator and denominator both will become 0. So in that case, how to obtain the limit?
L'Hospital rule, sir.
L'Hospital rule is applied here. It becomes minus of dH of S by dS. And then that becomes limit S tends to 0 minus H dash S. So this is how the time T naught can be computed. Okay. So here, what I told is inside whatever these brackets is there, na, that quantity is equals to S times of the definition of T naught in frequency domain. Now response times for general circuits. So response times for general circuits, what we have to do is we have to find out the step. We have to find out the response times t. So the equation of some may fail if S of S has a singularity in the right half of the S plane. So the limit, you will not get the value. So this is one of the difficulties. And knowing T naught, the value of T can be computed if delay is known. But normally this delay is not known in advance, you know. You know by computations, you know the transfer function only by computation. How to get the delay? So the delay is not known. So it may be difficult, however, to predict an actual time delay based upon the H function only, H of S only. So therefore, the computed times may from this as compared to experimental times. See, with experiments, you can determine. Experiment, by conducting an experiment, step response can be that you can obtain. But for theoretical these calculations, so the delay times and estimation of delay times becomes difficult from H of S. So, of course, you know, if we use the transmission line theory, then that can be computed. We will see soon that one. So these general results of TS, of course, can be applied to more detailed measuring circuits also. See, these four terminal electrode, whatever we have, you know, obtained until now. So by computing the transfer function and then finding out the step response, etc. So if it is this, if the, you know, system is small, or if the system can be assumed to be quasi-static, means there are no traveling waves, etc., then this will work easily. But if there are traveling waves, in actual practice, actually this divider system, the bearing system is so huge, if it will be of several meters high and several meters long also, so large space it will occupy. So a wave phenomena will occur in practice. So for that system, simple transfer function system, whatever we have studied, may not be exactly applicable. But the response times, etc., the calculation of response times, these are applicable for you know, even the distributed parameter systems also. Now, detailed representation of the four terminal network. Okay, so the four terminal lumped parameter network representation, that's what we have seen until now, of the measuring system has certain restrictions with the assumption that the electromagnetic phenomena are quasi-stationary in the two directions perpendicular to the direction of the wave propagation. So this assumption is made actually, but the actual system is a distributed network. It is not a lumped parameter network representation. Therefore, we have to consider traveling waves, etc. So the traveling time, for example, for a wave at the velocity of light is about 20 nanoseconds for 6 meters of length. 6 meters is not, you know, huge in a high voltage lab, real a big high voltage lab. So the length of the connecting, you know, leads or the entire dividing system, so will be around this order. So if that is so, even if the wave is traveling at the light velocity, of course it is not exactly light velocity. It's because there is, you know, finite permittivity and then, you know, mu r. So it is a reduced velocity only. But even if you consider light velocity, it is about 20 nanoseconds. So this 20 nanoseconds, if you consider, for example, a impulse wave chopped in the front region, it is, you know, the total, you know, time is 1.2, about 1.2 microseconds. So 20 nanoseconds means, you know, around the, you know, front chopping, if it occurs around 200 nanoseconds, so this is just roughly 10 times only. So 200 nanoseconds means it is just 10 times only whatever this delay time. So delay time becomes significant for that. For example, if impulses are chopped on the front in a few nanoseconds are considered, the time is only a few times longer than the delay of transmission line. So therefore, you know, the four terminal network approximation doesn't hold here for accurate analysis. So the theory of traveling waves or distributed parameters need to be used to evaluate the behavior of the system during the transients. So this is actually required for very fast transients. So this is the three component system. The four terminal system is, you know, again subdivided into three groups, the first group, second group, and third group. First one is a damping system, and second one is transmission system, then third one is terminating system. So damping system consists of that normally ZD is, you know, a resistor RD. That's what we have been talking about. So this is a damping resistor. So you can assume it as having inductance and all, that is a different story. But normally this is RD. This is damping system. And then transmission system. So the lead, other than the damping. Yeah. Now you can see, right?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah. How is my voice? Is it breaking?
No, sir. No, sir, it's clear now.
Okay. So the actual four terminal network is you know, divided into three parts. That is, first one is damping portion, and second one is transmission portion, and third one is terminating portion. So in the first one, it is simple that a damping resistor RD is considered to be this damping portion, and a transmission portion is mainly from the divider, from the, you know, test object to divider. So the lead constitute this transmission portion. So actually this impedance, surge impedance of that lead is ZL, is the surge impedance of the transmission line, and tau L is the delay of that transmission line. Means tau L is the time taken for the wave to travel from one end to the other end of the transmission line. That is called tau L. So this is how this transmission, you know, is transmission part is divided. And the third part is divider part. So this is also called terminating part. This constitutes mainly the divider and then measuring instrument and the signal cable, etc. So here, each part has a system matrix again, AD, AL, and AT. So the total system matrix is A, defined as AD into AL into AT. So this is how the three component system corresponding to the four terminal network is you know, divided into. Any question here?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Now, transmission line theory. Actually, to explain this, actually, you need to have the background of reflections and then transmission line reflection theory. So here, unless you understand that wave theory, it is difficult to explain. The final results are given here. So this is coefficient of reflection at a terminating point, and this is the coefficient of reflection at, you know, the divider end, the damping resistor end. So simply Z2 minus ZL divided by Z2 plus ZL, that's what it is, the, you know, reflection coefficient at any end. Here you can see ZL is in the middle portion. So what the reflection coefficient of the first one is reflection coefficient here at this end, and second one is the reflection coefficient at this end. So as you can see, there are two. For the first one, the transmission case is this portion Z2 and Z1 is ZL. Again, for this reflection coefficient, Z2 constitutes ZD, and then again this is ZL. So that's how the reflection coefficients are defined here. So if KT is the reflection coefficient at at the end between 2 and 3, and KD is the reflection coefficient at 1 and 2, then the transfer function HS is given by this complex equation. And the normalized step response, if of course ZD of S is equal to RD, means only resistor at the damping part is considered, at this part if only resistor is considered, then the equation for G of T, the normalized unit step response, becomes this. How is this actually? There are several exponential terms you can see. So have you heard of transmission line theory? How the wave travels on on a transmission line?
Yes, sir. Elementary, we have studied elementary about the traveling waves.
Traveling waves you studied, right? So at each end there will be reflection, and this reflection will be after a time tau of L, right? For example, if the transmission line delay is tau of L, then after every tau of L, so suppose a wave starts from here and then it reaches here, and here of course there will be initial reflection and it transmits, and then here there will be reflection, and then again reflection it reaches. But from here to here, there is a delay of tau L, and again from coming back also tau L, again to come back again is 3 tau L, right? Total, this is 2 tau L, this is 3 tau L. So that's how the transmission line, on the transmission line wave travels. Now, what kind of output do you expect here? Laplace inverse of this, if you take, actually it should match with step response only, but little bit different, right? So this is how the response will be actually, G of T. So here, this is after first tau L, it will reach here. After first transmission line delay, T tau L, it will reach that terminating point, and then at that instant it will rise, it will become like this. Of course here damping is not considered on the line. Of course damping will also be there on the line. So after that, after 3 tau L, then again the wave comes back. It goes, it goes to the other terminal and then comes back. So the duration between this is 2 tau L. So for every 2 tau L, it will come back to the terminal. There it will get reflected. The value becomes opposite, like this. And then it goes on diminishing, and then like this. This is how. So this is for a particular value of RD is equal to ZL by 2. What is ZL here? Are you following? What is ZL?
Terminating impedance.
No.
Surge impedance of transmission line.
Surge impedance of transmission line. What is that transmission line here? Physically, what is that transmission line?
Measuring cable.
Is it divider? Is it a test object? Is it a connecting lead? What it is?
Connecting lead, sir.
Yeah, it is connecting lead. Okay, so ZL is the surge impedance of the connecting lead. And then if RD, what is RD?
Damping resistor.
Damping resistor.
Damping resistor. If the damp is equal to ZL by root will be, damping resistor is increased to 2 ZL, you can see the response is damping. Okay. Value of suppose
sound is cut in between, so I am not able to understand.
If the damping resistor is ZL by 2, if damping resistor is ZL by 2, are you able to listen?
Yes, sir.
If damping resistor is ZL by 2, why it is not coming? Color is not. Sorry. Damping resistor, the response is this, you know, solid line, this one. And if damping resistor is 2 ZL, 2 times ZL, then the response is this dashed curve. So,
why is this completely red, sir? After dotted, you said the dotted graph RD is equal to 2 ZL from there.
So, with the increasing resistance, simply the damping is increasing. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So this is happening due to multiple reflections. Now, if you make the reflection coefficient as zero, for example, if RD is equal to ZL, RD is equal to ZL. RD means damping resistor value equals to surge impedance. If that is the case, then this value of KD is zero. KD means reflection at that end becomes zero. Very simply, transmission line, if there is a transmission line with terminating impedance equal to surge impedance, what will be the reflection coefficient?
Zero.
Zero, right? Similarly, in this case also, if we achieve that, there will be no reflection. Actually, the input and output will be like this. So that is the effect of this damping resistor. Of course, you know, this graph is obtained. This graph is obtained for a case RT greater than 1, greater than ZT. ZL. So in that case, see, I will just show the transmission line. Now here, only the effect of delay on the, you know, connecting lead is studied in this actually. So what is done is, if you consider this terminating, you know, impedance, this ZT as very high, then what will happen? It is complete reflection right here. And if you make this, you know, ZD at different values, if it is less, how the reflections will occur? If it is more, how the reflections will occur? And if this ZD equal to ZL, then how the situation will be? That is what is studied. So here, RT greater than ZL, this case, so KT becomes 1. So with KT equals to 1, and the second condition is RD less than ZL. So for that, this is studied. Now if RD becomes ZL, then KD becomes 0. And any reflection phenomenon will disappear. So this is in fact the reason why the damping resistor is placed at the input end of the lead. See, you can control the, you know, step response of the system except terminating portion, yes, except divider portion. We are not considering divider portion in, until now. So here, divider portion chodke, whatever is remaining portion, for that, these reflections and these step response can be controlled by controlling the value of RD. You can see clearly for less value of RD, what it is, and for high value of RD, what it is. And you can obtain a particular value of RD by which it closely matches the you know, step response, or closely you know, approaches the step response. Now here, how to compute the response time for this system is given here. These are the derivations obtained for you know, this three component system. So various times are given here in terms of impedances. No need to remember these things, just have in mind. Now, response time of the voltage divider or terminator TT. Now, here you can see the total response time T naught is a sum of TT plus tau L into this quantity, and then different times into these impedances, etc. Now, among these, this is actually significant value, tau T, TT. This TT is the delay in terminating portion, or, you know, response time of the terminating portion. What is terminating portion here?
The capacitive divider and measuring.
Okay. Ah, yes. The divider and the, you know, measuring cable, etc. This entire portion constitutes the terminating portion. So here, in this graph, whatever you have seen is other than that, actually. Other than that. So, for example, if it is, you know, few nanoseconds, if it is the delay time of the, you know, connecting lead is about 20 nanoseconds, you are observing this phenomena, 20 nanoseconds, and you know, this is 2 times plus 3 times 3 into 20. This is 60 nanoseconds. This is 5 into 20, 100 nanoseconds, like that. So this is, the entire phenomena is in few nanoseconds. Now here, apart from this time, actually here the response time of the divider is actually major portion. So that's why it is important to consider the response time of the divider itself separately. So other than this, you know, this one, the connecting lead system. So that's why divider system time is very important. In general, the voltage dividing system represented by the response time TT will actually control the transfer characteristics of the whole system, because it is the major portion given by this. It is justified to treat the terminating system separately, isolated, so to understand, isolated from the lead means connecting lead, to understand all HV dividing systems and their, you know, adequate applications. So that's what is done here. So voltage dividers and their response times. Actually, at the end of these computations, I will tell you. Until now, we have been concentrating on how to compute and all. So, but ultimately, what is to be done? See, in spite of all computations are some approximations, some limitations. See, for example, when we are considering this output response, we are assuming that at the terminating it is 100% reflection, so the you know the terminating effect we are ignoring in this portion. And when we are studying different parts, actually some assumptions are made, for some simplifying assumptions are made, and then some understanding we are trying to get one. Of course, you know, the ultimate thing is obtain a step response and measure the response time experimentally. So that is ultimate thing, but let us understand what is important, what is not important. So by studying this, we have, see, this is in few nanoseconds only entire thing. So by studying this, we understood that time T of T is very important. What is T of T? T of T is actually terminating, you know, response time, terminator response time. Terminator is nothing but a divider system and, you know, the measuring cable. So that having said that, now the how the dividers, how their response times are to be calculated now. So a distributed parameter network with equally distributed parameters is probably the best combined to simulate transfer characteristic by equivalent circuits. So let us see how the distributed parameter network will be, because see, except for that single capacitor system, the stacked capacitors or resistive dividers or, you know, RC dividers or all these will have different components, you know, several components connected in series, except for the single capacitor system what we have studied earlier, na? But that is of course very accurate, but at the same time very costly also. All other dividers will have series components. Now am I clear? Is it continuous? Voice is continuous?
Yes sir, voice is clear now.
Okay. So then therefore distributed parameter network analysis has to be done. Now the terminating system AT is now simulated by a large number n of elements or sections and the n impedances ZL dash in series are providing the voltage reduction. So you can consider, just I will show the equivalent circuit, several ZL dash. So in general I am talking about that ZL can be resistor, or you know, resistor in parallel with capacitor, or resistor in series with capacitor, so like that. So an equal number of impedances ZQ dash to earth are distributed along this column. Normally this ZQ dash to earth is simply CQ to earth will be there from a connecting lead or from a lead or some from a section. Normally what will be there, it will be the capacitance to the earth, right? So that capacitance to the earth is considered to be equal to the ZQ dash. So let us see how the equivalent circuit is. So this is the distributed parameter equivalent circuit of general voltage divider, any voltage divider. So you can see here ZLs are these series resistors. This is actually contributing to the, you know, divider ratio and all, that's what we consider. But sometimes stray capacitances will be there to ground, that can be considered as, you know, these impedances ZQ dash. So these actually capacitance to the ground will dominate compared to high voltage capacitance to high voltage lead. Therefore, these are considered dominant here. Now that ZL is equal to total impedance is equal to sigma of ZL dash, which is equal to, if n sections are there, n into ZL dash. Similarly, ZQ dash is, you know, they are parallel resistors, parallel impedances, equals to sigma of 1 by ZL dash inverse, so which is equal to ZQ dash by N. So simply the impedance will become, divided by N. So the normalized transfer function for this network, transfer function means this is the output here, V2, and this is the input. See, divider is given in a different way. These are all, impedances to ground actually. This is ground terminal. Right? And here also is ground terminal. So you see here, so for this network, the transfer function can be, simplified to be equal to this one. Of course, the final result only is given here. And nowadays, any complex circuit can be simulated in PSPICE. Those who, this is actually an interesting problem, how entire system responds. See, more than generation of high voltages, why we are spending more time on measurement circuits? Because measurement is sensitive actually. Measurement is very important and measurement is sensitive. It is affected by the transfer function of the system and especially for impulse voltages. For DC and AC voltages, it's not a big problem. For impulse voltages only you need transfer characteristics of the system, or that error of the system, and then the response times of the system to understand the this thing perfectly. So some of you, those who are interested, no? So these analysis were done long back. Those who are interested may take up this as a problem to understand and find out how the response times will change with different parameters. See, by changing the values of ZQs or ZLs, how these response times will. Of course, theory is available. That's what I am dealing with now. But it gives a good exposure and experience for those who are interested. And after obtaining this HT of S, GT can be estimated like this. Laplace inverse of 1 by S into HT of S. These quantities can be computed and analyzed for different equivalent circuits. Now, this is what actually this generalized circuit is given, a divider. But different equivalent circuits mean different dividers, we can see what it is. Now, N is by this definition equivalent to the voltage ratio of the divider. So, small n is voltage ratio of the divider, but it is different from capital N. Why? What is the difference between small n and capital N?
Small n is the section, sir, number of sections.
And small capital n is the, actually the divider ratio. Okay.
Capital n is the divider ratio, no, sir?
No. Capital N is input that to be measured at, test object. Okay. And output measured at divider output end. So, capital N is actually having larger scope. Means, for capital N, you have to take the input at the test object, not at the divider. But small n, simply divider ratio. Means, divider input terminal is what? That high voltage terminal is divider input terminal, right? So, here, the voltage V, capital V. So, when you calculate N, small n, it is, the meaning is, the input is this high voltage input and output is at the, output of the divider end. So, this is just limited to, small n is just limited to the divider, but capital N is limited to the system. You have connecting lead also, its impedance also. Okay. So, that is the difference. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, this is for a general divider. Here we have ZQ dash we have taken for, this impedance to earth, but it will be normally CQ dash. And ZL dash we have taken for the series components, which can be simple resistors for resistive divider. Of course, for resistive divider, some inductance will also be there, But that inductance, of course, can be neglected. Let us see. Now this complete equivalent circuit of a resistor voltage divider. Okay. So in this, what are the series components? Just now we have seen, right? So what are the series components? Actually, R dash should be there, right? Resistive divider, what will be there?
Resistance and
inductance
and between the leads capacitance is there.
Of the resistor wire, or you know, it is not a separate inductance that is made here. Okay, so this is, you know, for high frequency analysis we have to study this, taking this inductance also into consideration. So R in series with L, and between the connecting leads of R, see, R will have two terminals now. Between those two terminals you will have certain parallel capacitance also. So this entire impedance will be now the series impedance ZL, or you know, the divider impedance ZL. So ZL dash. So these are several components of ZL dash, n units of ZL dash, which are in series. And from each node to, there is a capacitance Cp. This Cq dash we have said earlier, right? Now Ce dash, it is given, the name is given as Cv dash. So these are earth capacitances. So that Zq dash becomes this Ce dash. So in that formula, in this formula, so there is Zq of S and ZL of S. So instead of this, you put that capacitance in parallel with resistor, in series with inductor, and here the earth capacitances, if we put those in this formula, we can easily show that the transfer function becomes like this. And from these, the GT step response can be estimated to be like this. After estimating this, we can compute the times T naught, right? So, but you know, for this exact circuit, T naught is not computed here. It is very complex. So what is done is here, the normally the inductance L and, you know, parallel capacitance P, Cp are, you know, neglected in a design. If that is so, if this inductance and this capacitance is neglected, this HTS can be approximately shown to be like this. So in that case, for that approximate case, so FB, the bandwidth, is can be shown to be 1.46 divided by RCE, and T naught, a response time, can be shown to be RCE by 6. What is this R? What is this R? And what is this CE?
R is equivalent resistance of divider.
Yeah, R is simply N into R dash. And CE?
All the summation of stray capacitances.
Yeah, R stray capacitances to earth, combined value. When they are parallel, they will become N times CE dash, right? Yes, CE equals to N times CE dash. Okay, so this is for the approximate circuit with neglecting these things. But if you neglect these things, this can be shown to be actually the equivalent circuit can be shown to be very simple like this, with a different CE value. So here, for that, actually GT of T is simply 1 minus exponential function, like this. It will be approaching like this. Of course, with those approximation. What approximation? CP dash and L inductance are neglected. So that is valid only for low frequency analysis, right? For a very high frequency analysis, we cannot do like that. So with for that approximation, so using this, it is shown that the T naught comes out to be this CR into CE by 6, which can we see small e. So we are comparing the previous network with this one to find out what is the value of this CE. So this CE is this for this circuit. For this circuit, simply, what is the time constant of this circuit? How do we determine time constant of any circuit?
Equivalent resistance and multiply with the resistance.
What you have to do is, you know, all voltage sources you have to short and current sources you have to open. Okay. Yes, and then a network is formed. So in that network, you have to compute, you know, what is the total resistance and what is the capacitance, C in parallel with R, whatever it comes. So here you can see if you do like this, this resistor will come in parallel with R2, R by 2. So this is R by 2, this is R by 2, both will be in parallel, right? So it will be R by 4. Why I have not considered this resistance?
From here we are taking the output actually.
This resistance I am not, why I am not taking?
So from here only we are getting the equivalent resistance and capacity.
For determining the
if you sort V2 voltage, then R gets also sorted.
Yeah, yeah, that is one way. You had to short the both the voltages to get the output. So otherwise also, even if this voltage source is not shorted, then this R2 value is very, very less than R. See, because that is the divider, right? N times less actually. So you can even ignore. So that is another point here. So this is CE into R by 4 is the, you know, time constant. So that is equal to RCE by 6, whatever is computed by the previous network. So if these are equated, then CE comes out to be 2CE by 3. So this network, whatever is given here, is an equivalent network for a distributed capacitance system actually. So in that, what is the value of CE? CE, if you use 2 by 3 of earth capacitance, total earth capacitance, and this network can be used for studying. So this is one important outcome of this result. But here, L equals to CP equals to 0 is considered, neglecting L and CP. So for a very high frequency analysis, this circuit cannot be used. Now, parallel mixed resistor capacitor dividers. So in this, resistor capacitor divider, actually resistive dividers, if you add some intentional capacitance in parallel for compensation purpose. So earlier we have seen, right? We have seen in very low voltage case, capacitors are added for compensation. So the similar concept is applicable here. So for that compensation, now you intentionally add some capacitance. Since you have intentionally added some capacitance, so it means that it is not negligible now. So if you include that into your analysis, so similar, the same equation if you substitute, so this will be the transfer function of the system. The same equation in that ZS, Z and ZL and ZQ you have to substitute. So if with this transfer function, if step response is computed, the step response will come out to be like this. It's a series, infinite series actually. So it will be like this. And for this step response, your time domain response is given here. So initially there will be an error of 6 CE by 6 CP. So this is what is given here. As time t tends to 0, the value is, you know, deviating from 1 by 6 CE by 6 CP. But however, at t tends to infinity, it is approaching to 1. So it is reaching 1. So this is the error you can see. So this is about the step response and from which t naught can be computed. The response time t naught can be computed by integrating up to this time. So this is about parallel mixed resistor capacitor dividers. And then we'll go to next, capacitor voltage dividers. These are actually stacked capacitor voltage dividers. Actually, but if it is a simple scale capacitor voltage divider, we cannot use this approximate circuit at all, because it is pure capacitance, and normally the low voltage arm is also arranged very close to the, you know, earth terminal of that one, or within the high voltage capacitor itself. Very carefully it is designed. So in that case, we can neglect the stray effects, but the cost of that construction is very high. So this equivalent circuit, whatever is given here, is applicable for stacked capacitor type voltage divider. So if that is so, then there will be a capacitor here and small inductance of the connecting lead from capacitor for the capacitor stack, and then some small resistance R, which is representing the loss in the capacitor. If you represent this capacitor in parallel, then the resistor value will be huge. Are you able to understand this one? When you represent the capacitor loss in series with the capacitor, then the resistance will be small. But if you represent the same capacitor with the loss with a parallel resistance, the resistance value will be huge. So both are equivalent only. Okay, both are equivalent only. But if you represent with series resistor, it will be small. But when you represent with a parallel resistor, the resistance value will be huge. Why is this so?
Not to pass current through it.
Yeah, actually the current here is negligible, so I square R loss small. Actually the loss capacitor is small only, so that's why here the current through the capacitor, the reactive current through the capacitor will flow, so therefore the resistance should be small to represent the same amount of losses. So that's why, so that's how it will work. Of course, the capacitor is represented here with a series inductance and then resistance. And then, of course, the parallel stray capacitance will be there. So this is clubbed with this like this. And from the leads to earth, again, earth capacitance will be there. So if you substitute all these, the response, the unit step response can be obtained like this. So this is how actually any number of circuits, any complex circuits can be analyzed, and the step response can be obtained theoretically. But until now, we have been discussing theoretically how to obtain the unit step response, and from that how to obtain the measuring times, right? Now, but ultimately, what is the target? Ultimately, how this is going to help? See, finally, how many approximate circuits, how approximations you may make, and how many approximations you may you may make equivalent circuits. But ultimately, what is important? Practically, whether that will work or not, that is important, right? So, all this theory put aside, ultimately, what matters to us is experimentally what is your step response and what is your delay time, because you may approximate the circuit with several these things, but it is not perfect, it is not complete. Some stray effects you may be missing. So that is why the standards always require to conduct an experimental test to find out the step response and then find out from that the response time. So this is the circuit for conducting the step response. Can we actually conduct the step response in actual situation? Actual situation means if you were to conduct the step response in actual conditions, what is needed? There is a test object of very huge height and you have to generate a step input of very high voltage and that to be connected to an electrode at a very high height, and there you have to inject this step response and then find its output voltage, measure its output voltage. So it is actually a difficult task. Of course, several people have tried, but not so successful. Some people claim that they have successfully conducted the experiment, but what IEC standards will specify, na? So this is how the circuit is there. So here, a DC input is to be given. So this is a DC supply. And then this is the charging resistor. So after connecting this DC resistor, so then this is the charging resistor. Initially, this switch is open. The switch is not connected. And there is a resistor RD here. And then C is fast switch. D is vertical lead. This is vertical lead. This should go vertically above and until the height of the divider is reached. And from there, this is high voltage lead, HV lead. And then this is voltage divider, F. And then from here, it is going to recording cable, through recording cable. So here the output will come. So output is to be recorded here at this end, at the oscilloscope. Now, how this pulse is generated here?
Generator?
This is DC. This is DC. How to generate a pulse? See, step response means what? You have to give a step input to the system. What is our system? Our system consists of RD. This is test object actually. Then RD, then divider system, then measuring cable, and then oscilloscope. This is oscilloscope. So like this it was, if you remember. So similar system we are creating here. So instead of generating step response at the input near the test object, what is done here is the RD is shifted here and there is a vertical lead coming down. And from there it is connecting to the DC source through a charging resistor. Okay, and there is a switch here. So suppose initially DC is applied, and when DC is applied, the system will, after some time, the system will be charged and then it reaches steady state, right? Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
And after that, suddenly if I close this switch, then what will happen?
Discharge will happen, sir.
So the voltage is made zero, right, suddenly?
Yes, sir.
So it is, it is actually initially like this, and then it is making like this. Do you understand? Initially, some value, some step value is there, and then at a certain instant of time, I am switching it off. It is becoming zero. So this is also a step response. You understand? This is negative step response. Okay. So the final value, how it is reached, if you study the waveform, what kind of waveform do you expect? What kind of waveform do you expect? Okay, I will draw and show you. So this is the final value, right? This is the final value, this green. Now this will be reached in a manner like this. Do you understand? Or it may be like this in overdamped case. So this is how we will obtain, and after obtaining this, we have to find out this area, that's it. One positive, one negative, one positive, one negative. So like that, we will obtain the response time T naught. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Okay, here, instead of applying a positive step, initially it is connected to DC, and suddenly that DC is made zero by connecting a switch, by closing a switch. So suppose if I close this switch, the potential at this node will be zero, right? Earlier the potential is equal to V, whatever the source voltage is there. Now, does it not create any problem if I suddenly close the switch here? Will there be a problem?
If jumping resistor is a 5 value, then there is no problem. Otherwise, spark will create. If we get a, give a time, time for decaying, then there is no problem. If you try to discharge suddenly, then there is a problem. That's why given a damping resistance hardiness.
Plus minus. This is plus minus VDC. So if there is a problem, the problem should be the source only. So we have connected this switch, but there is a resistance here, the charging resistance. So you have to choose this charging resistance adequate enough to limit the current also. This current I also should be limited when you are closing the switch. So that is the precaution you have to take. So with this kind of setup, actual experiment has to be conducted, and from that tau naught and then tau t should be estimated. So this experimental method, even the delay time also, you will get perfectly with this setup. If you use proper transmission line, this transmission line is the proper transmission line. Of course, a little bit deviation from the actual experimental condition is there. That deviation is, we are bringing the high voltage lead down here through the resistor RD, and then here at the at this level we are applying the voltage source. So some deviation is there, but more or less this method gives accurate results and is accepted by the standards, IEC standards. So this is how experimental it is done. And then the last point of this is, the device low voltage. So here, until now, we have considered divider and then how to find out the experimental this thing, experimentally the response times. But the divider's low voltage arm, needs specific attention. Here, you have a delay cable. Of course, bandwidth is not a problem for this delay cable at all. We can make the system, with high bandwidth, the lossless, almost lossless cables are available. So it's not a big problem. Like, the connecting lead from test object, we do not have any control there because the size has to be huge and then height has to be huge. So you cannot control there. But here, this delay cable or measuring cable, you can divide this system perfectly and the bandwidth can be decided, can be made very high so that it won't affect the accuracy of the system. So, but other than accuracy, certain important things you have to consider here. So that is what is, you know, terminating impedance. How to terminate the cable. Otherwise, there will be reflections, oscillations on this cable. So there are different methods here for terminating the cable. For four different cases, you can see here. Here, this is the resistance divider or resistance in parallel with capacitance. So for this type of divider, you can see here. So there is R2 here. This R2 will be in parallel with this ZK here. Okay, this ZK comes in parallel with this. But what will happen, the wave, whatever appears here, it will travel up to this and again see this impedance R, which is equal to ZK. So since R is equal to ZK, will it come back from this? Reflection. When the terminating impedance is equal to the surge impedance of the cable, will there be a reflection? So here ZK is the surge impedance of the cable, tau K is the delay of the cable, CK is the capacitance of the cable. Now what is done here is, there is a resistor which is equal to ZK. Then whether the transmission line, the transmitting wave, whatever reaches at this terminal, will it get reflected?
No, sir.
No, sir.
It will not get reflected. Simply, it will come back and then here, whatever value is there, that value will appear on the oscilloscope. So do you understand? If this resistor is not there, the situation will be different. So since this resistor is there, whatever comes here is terminated here. Since R is equal to ZK, so ZK value is nothing but R. So here, R2 in parallel with R, you have to consider for deciding the divider ratio. So this is C1, R1 is there, is C2, and R2 in parallel with R will be there here at this end. So that is deciding the divider ratio. And whatever appears here, the wave will simply travel and the same wave will be displayed on the oscilloscope. There will be no change. And let us consider the second case in which only capacitors are there. Capacitive, pure capacitive divider. See, for pure capacitive divider, we cannot connect a parallel resistance. Please remember, whenever there is a capacitive divider, you cannot connect a parallel resistor simply because it will reduce the, you know, it will alter the impedance. See, that's why never a parallel resistor is connected. But here you can see there is a series resistance here. How this is going to affect the values, let us see. Here is that. Now here, whatever wave is impinged on this, at this node, okay, at this node, now what will be the value of that voltage at this node?
The voltage minus the drop, sir.
No, actually, the cable's input impedance comes in series with this. So you can...
R divided by ZK plus R.
This is, you know, this is like this. The cable's surge impedance, ZK, comes in series with this. This is R, this is ZK. And the whatever is the division of the voltage between these two will appear here. Now here you can see R is made equal to ZK. This is ZK. So what will happen to the voltage here? Whatever appears, suppose V is appearing here, this will become V by 2. Do you understand?
R is equal to ZK, no, sir?
R is equal to ZK.
Yes.
Now this becomes V by 2, and here this V by 2 wave travels this end, and it sees there is no impedance connected here, means the terminating impedance is infinity. Then in that case, what will happen to the voltage wave, whatever is reaching here? A voltage wave
totally gets reflected, sir.
It will become double. A voltage wave which is reaching the open end will become double. So that will become again V at this end. So there will be no difference in the voltage magnitude. It was V here, it became V by 2 here, and that V by 2 traveled, and at this end it became V, and then again reflects back. But when it reflects back, this capacitor becomes shorted because it is a high frequency component. And then the reflected wave which is coming back will see simply this resistance R, which is equal to ZK. So there will be no further reflections. Please try to understand. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So I repeat. V here becomes V by 2 here, and V by 2 travels here, becomes V here, and then it again travels back here. But here it sees same impedance ZK, it will not further reflect. That's it. The steady state value is reached. So this is what I said. So you try to understand. If you have doubts, again you ask me. And in some cases, actually the capacitor divider case only, in some cases, because there will be some difference in the initial capacitance and final distances, in some case, done like this. Okay, so in this case, this R3 and R4 both are equal to ZK, but in this case, try to evaluate here, there will be difference in the voltage seen here. So it will be half of the voltage, because here Z2 by R3 and ZK will be in series, and half of the voltage will appear, that will travel here, but here it will see the same impedance R4, which is equal to ZK. It will not come back. Therefore, it will see V by 2 only here. So that is the only difference. But for that, it will eliminate the lossy effect that can occur in this part of the circuit. So, but you know, even this will work. And the last one is a cable here. This is RC type of the divider. In this case, the resistance used here is ZK minus R2. So ZK minus R2 and is in series with ZK. That is the voltage divided here. And then that voltage will travel here. Here it will become double. And the double waveform will come back and then see just ZK here. Total impedance is ZK, and it will not have further reflections. But remember, the voltage seen by CR, voltage measured by CRO, is not exactly the voltage that is what is appearing here. V is divided between ZK minus R2 and ZK, and here it becomes double of that value. But of course, it will not get back the reflection. The reflections we are controlling, but the value we are seeing in this case is not equal to the value whatever appears here. You can theoretically calculate what is the exact value that is seen here by following the simple procedure. But in this case also, and in this case also, the voltage, whatever is divided here, will actually appear on the oscilloscope due to automatically correcting the value by terminating impedances. You just go through once, and if you have any further doubts, you can ask me. Other than this, the layouts of low voltage arm. See, the resistive divider is there. So from the low voltage arm, bottom of the resistive divider or capacitive divider or RC divider, taking the lead without getting the influence from the external fields is very, very, very important, because the voltages are very small there. So you have to carefully extract the voltage and connect the coaxial cable. So here, this is the coaxial cable terminal, you can see. It is at the bottom of the device. This entire device system is at the bottom of the high voltage divider. So from high voltage divider, that high voltage arm, you are getting the lead like this. So it should be carefully taken inside. This is, you know, shielded, this thing, shielded, metallic box, which is also grounded, you can see. And through this annular space, you have to carefully take inside. And then this is the network components R2C2, or, you know, compensating networks or network elements. And here, this is matching impedance. And from that, the cable, coaxial cable starts very carefully. So here, the coaxial cable, even the opening from the coaxial cable is not exposed to outside this thing to avoid the influence. So the shielding, you see, very carefully inside a metal box, it is, everything is arranged. And then carefully from the metal box, without even opening the shielding, the outside, there will be a shielding for coaxial cable also. That outer layer of the coaxial cable will also act as a shield. And then centrally, you are taking the measuring lead. And it will go, and then at oscilloscope also, you have this outer shield again, and oscilloscope, it will enter into the oscilloscope, so oscilloscope's network, and then where it is measured carefully. So this is one type of layout, and there is another layout also. Here in this case, so more or less similar only, but for this metallic copper disc here. So your high voltage arm is reaches a metallic disc, and from that you have several this resistive or capacitive components. And then here, this is terminating impedance or matching impedance, and from that the signal cable is taken here. So this is how again it goes to oscilloscope, and then where it is read. So this is now with this, the measurement portion of high voltages is complete now. If you have any questions, you may ask now. Hello. Hello, are you able to?
Yes, sir, we are getting you.
Okay, now what you do is, once you go through, okay, the video, I will send it today itself. Once you again go through, and then carefully try to understand, and if you have questions, you can ask me. Now itself, you can ask me, but after that also, we will sit once and then clear. Okay, today I tried to cover, a little bit more syllabus, so it may be heavy for you, I don't know. Did you follow, or, there was some break?
Followed, sir, just need to once revise once, check it out.
Okay, so just go through once, and then... See, the objective is to understand the systems, rather than writing an exam, or that are all secondary. But try to get the subject so that that will be useful to you in life. Okay.
So, sir, this is the end of the syllabus for entire course or only for measurements?
For measurements. Okay. I will take a few more lectures and then finish that one. But of course, few more lectures are there. This is only for measurements.
Okay, sir.
Sir, what doubt is there?
Don't worry about your test. Its weightage is about 25 marks only. And then, don't worry about that. You try to learn the subject. That's what is the objective.
Sir, one thing I wanted to ask that in the beginning of this lecture, we again in the last lecture also we studied about normalized amplitude frequency spectra of the lightning impulse. In that, sir, when we have a full lightning impulse waveform, then you said that the bandwidth for it is 5 to 10 megahertz. But as from the figure, we can see that it dies down after 0.5 megahertz. So why we are taking the bandwidth so large?
No, for safe side, it should be around 5 to 10 times whatever we are getting. Okay, because you are assuming this idealized impulse, input impulse, right? But idealized input impulse normally generating is difficult. Always there will be high frequency components in generated waveform. The reason is, so your system, generating system itself is not free from stray effects, right?
Yes, sir.
So you are assuming pure capacitors in your generating system, but always there will be stray inductances to the leads and all. So
yes,
actual generated voltage and then this ideal theoretical voltage is different. That's why we always have certain, safety.
So yeah. For the front chopped impulse waveforms, we would be needing a very high amount of bandwidth. So.
Yeah.
Okay, sir, when would you send the marks, sir? Mid semester.
Tomorrow I will send the marks. Okay, I will go there and then.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
In previous two slides, sir.
Huh?
In previous two slides, yeah.
Previous two slides.
So there are four diagrams we have shown. Seen.
Which diagrams are shown?
This four one? Diagram. No, sir. In previous, huh? This one, sir. Four diagrams are shown. The first is B and D, okay, sir. But for A and C, there have been a loading effect because the resistance and are connected across the CRO, which has an infinite input impedance, which creates. Hello.
No.
Hello.
This.
Sorry, boss.
The issue is R1 by R2. Simple R1 by R2.
Sorry, boss is baked, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, of course, the divider ratio gets modified.
Yes, sir.
That is what you may say, loading effect. But you have to consider this R coming in parallel with R2.
Yes, sir.
That's what is considering the loading effect, right?
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, okay. Sir. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome. Yeah. Okay, I'm closing the presentation. We will meet again on Monday.